Northern Soul is like a religion, really. It's an escapist scene for escapists.
It was just this sort of fantastic energy.
Oh, man, it is such a buzz.
The dancing was tremendous. I mean, it was spectacular.
Just music you hadn't really heard before. And the dancing was awesome.
Everybody seemed to know each other.
It was freedom and liberty. The main thing was the music was fucking immense.
You have the dancers, you have the DJs, and you have the collectors, and it's all linked in. It's a lifestyle.
They look good, they feel good.
It's responsible for loads of things, and for a lot of people.
Literally, it was the biggest, by far the biggest discotheque the world's ever seen.
Northern Soul's fast-rate 60s soul music to dance to and spin to and talk about and have love affairs to.
It was just embraced by a community.
You know, it's an addiction. It's the hook.
In 2.5 minutes, life is magic.
There's something cool going on up north.
When people get into something and it takes over their lives, you know, they don't want to let it go.
You get out on that dance floor and you rock it. For me, that is quintessential Northern Soul.
It's about the moment, the time, about breaking new records, getting up, going out, dancing and love.
Shit made me bald though, look.
Northern Soul took off in Britain, in the north of Britain, that's why it's Northern Soul. Because life was so bloody boring back then, you know. Jobs were crap and there wasn't much expectancy of getting out of your crappy job, and you wanted to escape at the weekends. And the only thing that was on offer when I was a young man was your complete Wally discos with all the glam rock and all that going off. Heavy metal. And that way you had to pee on your jeans and bite the head off chickens and look hard. And then this Northern Soul scene, which was for escapist people who were a bit more up there. It was like, woo, this is exciting. This is this underworld thing, which it was the only underworld scene at the time.
I think one of the reasons that Northern Soul took off in the UK is that we have government-controlled radio. And in the 1960s and in the early 1970s, if you wanted to hear certain records, the only way that you could get to hear them was to go to a nightclub. Tony Blackburn wasn't playing these on the radio. Johnny Walker wasn't playing these on the radio, so you had to go to a nightclub. The other reason, I think, is that northern working class kids, generally speaking, rejected hippiedom. And a lot of people in the south kind of started doing different drugs and basically kind of adopting more of the kind of hippie ethos, and I don't think that ever really touched the North in the way that it did the South, probably because it was more economically deprived. And I think those are the two main factors why Northern Soul kind of coalesced in the way that it did.
Well, Wigan Casino, I think, is one of those places that really everything happened at the right time. A lot more interest in the Northern Soul music. But nobody had the capacity that we had at Wigan Casino.
Around the mid-70s, 75, when at the time Studio 54 was perceived as being the biggest discotheque in the world, and the casino was voted number one, putting that into second place, that put into context how big Northern Soul was. It was the biggest youth culture.
Could really emulate the place itself, the dance floor, the friendliness, the DJ roster, etc., and really the sounds that we were producing.
You were having to queue for 3 hours to get into a crumbling, decrepit building. People lived and breathed for the casino, and to be honest with you, if the capacity at that time had been 10,000, then I think they would have hit lockout every time. It was simply the biggest thing ever.
One of my girlfriends said to me, you need to come to Wigan. So then we all jumped on a train, straight from work, jumped on a train, got down there and was just totally won over by the atmosphere. Everybody was really friendly, there was no fighting, there was no bags getting stolen. It was just fantastic. People just on the floor dancing their socks off all night long. It was fantastic. And we just got hooked.
I dropped my bag out my bedroom window and then told my dad I was off to clean my shoes and just fuck off for the weekend, basically, and not come back.
Everybody would be doing their normal 9-to-5 jobs all week, and when the weekend came, it was on with the short socks, the long skirts and T-shirts, and off down to Wigan.
I used to get turned back hitchhiking all the time. I'd go onto the A1, hitch, the police would stop me. By that time, they knew me. Oh, Paul, yeah, get back, you're not old enough to hitch.
We'd go to Sheffield, do their midnight session, and then go somewhere else, the Wigan Casino, and do the late night session, 4 o'clock in the morning. Carrying the hammer organs and shit through the audience, right? You know, no back door. You gotta carry it through the audience. And when one group finishes, next group pop on. That group finishes, the next group pop on. Oh man, it was such a buzz.
There was lots of kids traveling from Aberdeen all the way down to Bolton, which was unheard of. Most people would never travel that far just to have a dance.
A lot of people remember the Northern Soul scene for the dancing, because the dancing was tremendous. I mean, it was spectacular, you know. I was quite good myself.
In the early 70s or mid-70s, it was a pounding dance beat that was needed to get people on the dance floor. You got what they used to call 100-mile-an-hour dancers.
Certain records that were probably considered more for the boys, big stompers where they could do their high kicks and their spins and splits and all the rest of it, and the more melodic ones are more the girly tunes.
I was in a shit environment that I hated doing stuff I didn't want to do, and I loved dancing. It was the first time a northern male was it was okay to dance.
The reason that northern soul dancing took like the jazz dancing of the 40s or the rock and roll dancing, which had gone before, and took it to a different level, was martial arts. When we first went, it was like just like the basic rock and roll dancing, backdrops and all that, a bit of spin into the splits. But then when Bruce Lee arrived, whoomf, it all changed. You know, that bugger's just gone up the wall and landed on his head and spun here, and his legs go, right, I've got to do that, but I'll do it with one hand.
Yeah, I used to practice in my mum's living room with my little brothers and my sister. And we'd all put our caps on our heads. My little brother used to do the splits. I'd show them how to spin. And we used to do little shows on a Friday night for my mum.
And I remember the first guy I saw dancing was a guy called Stock. And I saw him dance to this record. And I was like, all these women looking at him. I was like, fuck, I want to be him, mate.
Well, I used to go to the Taekwondo Club when we were training, and I'd practice wee dance moves afterwards. I've got to work something out to beat these bastards.
You know, I destroyed half my mum's living room and the ornaments practicing acrobatics, you know, because a little council house practicing these moves. And so there was a great sense of freedom dancing to records, you know, when you hit a spin right and whatever. It was empowerment if you crap at everything else.
Ooh, my legs can do this and that, and I can do that on the floor, so I'll go round there, I'll do a hook and kick, spin round, woof.
When you go to your first all-nighter, you tend to just sit there at the back of the room on a chair, not moving anywhere really, watching the floor, watching the dancers, practice a couple of the steps, but you look a right twat, so you soon sit down again. 5 months later, maybe you're on the edge of the dance floor, but still leaving the big boys in the middle to it. And then one day, without realising it, obviously you're dancing and you just look up and you're there, you're in the middle. It's just like, you know, hey mother, I've arrived.
moves that were so essentially, or are so essentially, Northern Soul, but they've permeated every single tribe ever since. You know, you see the drops in hip-hop, breakdancing, you know, that whole competitive spirit of who can do the better spin, who can do the better drop, you know, challenging each other on the dance floor. It's all there and it's all Northern Soul.
And the dancing was awesome. Some of those kids were just fantastic. I mean, you're talking pre-breakdancing, you know, but serious showing off, but wonderfully fit, you know, people. And the great thing about it was that the clothing was this part of saying, look at me, I've got a jacket with two pockets. Look at me, I've got a jacket with three pockets. Look at me, I've got a vent that's 12 inches. They started off, you know, normal trousers and slowly got wider and wider. And then, of course, they got higher in the rise and the waistbands got higher and higher. And it was all about, you know, self-expression, which was pretty amazing, really, because it was a very working class thing. To be a working class kid and to think about how you looked was actually quite, you know, quite unusual and quite different, you know, different. Your probably dad thought you were, you know, what's he looking, what's he worried about how he looks, you know? It's like, you know, be a serious bloke, you know, stop messing about, you know. But they just really went for it. And of course, the thing I loved the most was all the badges, you know, they'd like Night Owl and All Nighter. Of course, they used to sew them all over their vests and over their bags. And they used to take those beer mats, the cloth beer mats, and then sew those onto the back of their trousers or onto their bags or whatever. So it was very very creative stuff.
Well, fortunately for me, I can sew. I used to make quite a few of my own skirts and stuff. Most of them had like pleats in them, so that when you done your spin, they stuck out at an angle. You do your little swish to stop your skirt from going round. There wasn't very many places that you could go and buy a full circle skirt. We would be scouring every shop, every boutique to find a skirt that done the job.
And then everybody, of course, had this, you know, like bag, which was like a sports bag, and that was used for taking a spare change of clothes in because it got so hot and sticky and smelly, probably.
You could never go to Wigan without your bag, and in your bag would be your clean t-shirts, clean undies, the big knickers so that when you'd done your spin you weren't exposing yourself, and probably a clean pair of ankle socks because you had to have your nice clean socks on, and deodorant, lots of deodorant.
They bought quite a lot of things from me when they used to come down to the shop. In fact, not things that necessarily were part of that the obvious scene. Apart from Paul Smith things, I used to get a lot of vintage from America, 501 Levi's before you could get them, you know, carpenter's pants, you know, that were very baggy. And so some of the more individual kids used to buy stuff like that, probably to look different from everybody else. I remember a solicitor was trying on a suit, and his wife was sitting there, and then there was two kids from the Northern Soul scene trying on things. I think it was Hawaiian shirts. I had lots of short sleeve Hawaiian shirts. And they both came out at the same time, and the guy was in a flannel suit and the boy was in the shirt. And he looked in the mirror, he went in front of the mirror like this, and this solicitor's wife was sitting there like looking. And then the guy just did two back flips. He went like this, and the woman was like, and he went, yeah, that's okay, that's fine. Because that would obviously be all right for dancing in, you know. And the solicitor was in his grey flannel suit, like, amazed at all this sort of stuff that was going on.
Everybody is too busy looking good, partying down. You know what I'm saying? They look good, they feel good. The women are looking good, the booze is good, the music is good. How can you not? You know, it's a place to have more glad for the stride. You know what I mean? Then I had more loot for the suit. You know what I mean? Shakespeare, you know.
This was everyone coming together and enjoying the music. You know, one love, one world, one spirit, really.
I never heard one word bad said about anybody of anything of colour. Nobody was interested in colour. Everybody was just interested in the music and the atmosphere and just being part of it. It was one of the best things happen anyway for us, a lot of teenagers at the time.
It was a safe alternative environment for like-minded people.
A lot of the way you survived was either selling some of the singles that you had maybe got two of, or swapping, and there was a big swapping scene going on, which was fantastic.
I started collecting in 1973, and I came on the Northern Soul scene as a 13-year-old. Got hooked straight away, and then it took me on many travels.
A few people that were really into collecting and really want to know about it started to take flights over to America. Well, these records that have been lying on dusty shelves and been sold off cheap in second-hand record shops, they were finding them.
And from then, that was it. You know, the focus was going to the States. Everyone would go to the States and look for obscure label American soul, whip it back, and, you know, at that time you could go out there and it was like, you know, 10 cents each or even less, you know, 10 for a dollar, 20 for a dollar. Who the hell wants that muck? Don't you want road, doo-wop and rockabilly? Have this stuff. So there was, very quickly, a hoor of a lot of tunes arriving in Britain.
The cab driver took us to this record shop, it was Coachman's, which is in a place called East Jefferson in Detroit. And we walked into this store, two white guys walking into this store, and you could have heard a pin drop. There was a few people in there and everybody stopped. We afterwards, once we'd explained where we were from or what we were doing, they told us the thought that we were police. The only white faces they ever saw in the neighborhood were policemen. So they were very suspicious of us at first, but when they found out we'd come from England, they were very helpful.
The raw music was being found. Interesting labels, artists you'd never heard of, things you've never seen.
Most of it was made by small labels in America who were really trying to be the next Berry Gordy. They were all trying to be Motown. And because America's such a vast country, and a lot of these things relied on local distribution, they simply fell through the cracks in distribution. So often they were the kind of the failures and outcasts of wannabe Motowns throughout the whole of the United States. And everyone else had forgotten them, apart from obsessive northern working class blokes with mustaches who collected soul records. So they turned from being these failures in the United States to being incredible rarities and collector's items in the UK.
I first got wind that the record was doing something when it was first released. And they told me that you had some popularity in England. But they didn't tell me just how great it was. This is the record company.
We were called D-Town, but we didn't have the money like Motown, because Mike Hanks and Berry Gordy were enemies. And, well, the scam goes on. I never received an accounting.
They didn't want you involved in the business. They just wanted you to record. They didn't want you to have too much knowledge of the business.
The creative end became much better, but the lucrative end avoided me. Although they made it avoid me, obviously.
Black people in America were suppressed, really. They got things to say, but of course they couldn't publicly say that we're black and we're being exploited by white people.
You know, all the big record companies are talking about how Napster is ripping them off, but how many artists have they ripped off?
When they're talking about, you know, deep emotions like falling in love, you know, wanting somebody, losing somebody, this kind of thing. Sometimes I seriously, honestly believe what they're saying is, we're getting shafted and we don't like it. We feel terrible, we can't say it. So our approach to this is this way. When you talk to some of the artists that come over now and they see how the British, not the British public, but the people involved in this kind of thing, how they feel about these records, I'd imagine it's, you know, it's the best payment they've ever had. And it's probably gonna be the only payment they're ever gonna have.
I find out that the records have been very prevalent here in this country. And people have been brought up for 30 years or more on Bobby Hutton music. Now that's a mind blower.
Anytime an artist is appreciated for his creation, that's the highest price that you will ever receive in life, way and above monetary values.
The British people are very smart, and the disc jockeys are very smart. And somebody else is very, I don't have to say it.
The shock of seeing these kids like that to the American artists come all the way to the other side of the world, to a place outside of Sheffield or Manchester or Leeds and all of that. Thousands of kids are going, you're right, you're right. Give us another tune like that. You're right.
They're great dance records. They have a brilliant lyrical content. And that's what makes a great dance record.
And soul, you got to get in their face. You got to tell them the story that they can relate to. My baby left me. She's breaking my heart. I got all of this and this and this, but without my baby, I ain't got a damn thing. You understand that? So the average person can go, hey, well, I can identify that. Hey, I ain't got mine.
Let's not forget that any black music scene in this country has always been driven by not just the music, but what the drugs were that were guiding that scene.
When you first went to an all-nighter, fair enough, we used to break into chemists and get speed, which was government approved, and it was healthy stuff. But the reason we took it is we were travelling down for Aberdeen and all that. It took us 12 hours to get there. You were dancing for 8 hours at night, then 12 hours to get home the next morning. And you took it because you were going to be knackered if you didn't and you wouldn't enjoy the night. It got a wee bit out of hand and folk were taking as many drugs as they could take so they could get blocked, you know, with their heads.
Stuff at the time, because it was pharmaceutical, used to have time release in it, you know, because they were used for dietary supplements and whatever. So stuff like Black Bombers, you could take them, and if you mistimed it, you could be at school on Monday, you know, and get little flashbacks of time release. So you'd...
I remember we did a chemist in Aberdeen in about 1978, and this wee red light started beeping, and I'm like, what the fuck is that, okay? And technology had caught us up, and after about a year that was the end of government approved drugs, and you started getting homemade drugs arriving, and it killed a lot of people. Like, one of my mates died from it. There was an all-nighter at Wakefield with 12 dead in the morning.
I was like a mascot with the crew of people that I hung around with, so I just take what they gave me. At that time I hated the environment I was from, and then, you know, I started skipping school and stuff and waiting for the all-nighters all week. And I'd just nip out in the evenings, you know, and they'd pop stuff in my hand, and it ended up, you know, stuff like Mogadon or Tunol or whatever. And I think the mixture killed all my white blood cells. So my mum came home and found me unconscious in a pool of vomit, actually. And I went to hospital, and that was my first ban from all-nighters when I was, I was still at school. I think I was 16 then.
The people that I actually knew, there was probably about 14 deaths in 1 year, all linked to taking the speed to keep them going all night, and then the downers to bring them back to earth the next morning, and eventually the downers overtook the speed, and they were very young, like 18, 19 years old at the time. So yeah, there was a downside to it as well.
The council who owned the casino mentioned in the mid-70s that they were wanting to extend the civic centre, which was actually adjacent to the casino, and thus the casino would have to be pulled down. So the night that I never ever wanted to go, and I don't think anybody else wanted to go, was December the 6th, 1981, because that was the time that the casino actually finished.
Everybody was just clapping, were crying, everybody's running around trying to steal a bit of the wallpaper if there was any left, the wet, soggy wallpaper. Just heartbreaking, really, because it was like the end of the end.
Yeah, that last night was awful. It was terrible. Just left the stage then, picked up my records and went, drove home with it in tears, really. And that was the last time ever at the casino.
I know I was crying. I know there was a lot of my friends were crying. I seen a few tears in a few guys' eyes as well. It was like that there was never going to be another Northern Soul record played ever in the universe. So we felt it. You know, we really felt it. It was really sad. At the end of the night, every single person in the casino would clap along to the music. Just to feel it, it made all the hairs in the back of your neck stand up. It was amazing. It was like everybody was one person for that moment. And it was our way of saying thank you to the Northern Soul for being such a big part of our lives. It was like I'd found a family outside my own family. And I really missed it for a long, long time.
Call me, baby, whenever he makes you blue. Call me, whenever your world is sinking through. Oh, yeah, listen, honey, I'll be there on a double. Ease your mind. And take away your trouble. Call me, I want moment, baby. Stopping to get his way. Oh yeah. Call me whenever your man do you wrong. Call me whenever he leaves you all alone. Oh yeah. Listen, honey, I'll be there. Supply your every need. Satisfaction is truly guaranteed. Call me, hour, moment, baby. Something that you get this way. Listen, honey, this is what I do for you. Whenever.
I don't know which is worse. They left it up for 6 months. So keep driving past and seeing the building there where you met so many people and so many friendships and so many people have come from all around the country. It was terrible, and then, funnily enough, it caught fire. It was like just watching, you know, everybody's hearts being ripped apart. The last thing to go is where the stage was, and in fact the grand piano that they couldn't get off the stage, so the grand piano was there really until the very, very last minute.
When the casino closed, I think we really did enter the wilderness years of Northern Soul. I think the scene dwindled to probably less than 5,000 people worldwide then. There were people that tried to keep things going. There were smaller all-nighters, all these kind of venues that probably most of the people that are watching this film won't have ever heard of, but they just about kept the flame burning.
Eventually we settled on the 100 Club in, I think it was late 1980, perhaps early 1981, and that was just yet another convenient club about the right size, held 300 people for a monthly dance and get together. A lot of the Northern fans were getting fed up of the amount of pop that was getting played, and people glad to get back to the roots of the original soul records, and from our first dance we sort of sold the place out virtually, and just amazingly we never got thrown out, and we've been there for, well, I suppose nearly 25 years that the 100 Club just kept going.
I play around the world with my punk stuff, and I'm going to clubs in Barcelona, and there's youngsters in their early 20s, late teens and all that, coming up and asking me, have you got any Northern Soul? You used to be a Northern Soul DJ.
As you probably know, I work a lot in Japan. I've been sort of over 80 or 100 times or something. And I've been working there since the early 80s, and they just love stuff. I mean, they just get passionate about
things. Obviously, the Northern Soul scene is just part of that.
Young kids have come over to London from Japan. They're looking for something trendy. Some of them might have stumbled across the 100 Club all night, or, you know, thought, oh, what's this? Oh, this is interesting.
I think the Northern Soul scene is 関西の方が今はすごく盛り上がってると思うんですけど、でもノーザンソウルはやっぱり踊るのがすごい楽しいっていうのがあって、で私もすごく踊るのが好きだから、それでノーザンソウルにもっと興味を持ちました。第一にスピン、第二にバックドロップ、
第三にキック、第四にレッグスリップ。
I did this project a few years ago where I made a lot of the old clothes again, and I bought lots of the singles that I found from various shops and contacts around the world actually. And I did a bit of an exhibition in my shop in Tokyo. And it was so popular, I mean, it really was. But what was very interesting was the magazines would come and they'd be so informed about it. And they'd go, oh, you've got that, have you? You've got that single on. Oh, bummy on bags. And, you know, so they were completely clear on it.
I do hang around with the, you know, all the sort of influential DJs in the States just now, and the whole lot of them are getting that attitude now. They're all like, ah, to hell with this rubbish, let's go back to the past, it was much better. And that's a Northern Soul type spirit. I'm playing a set of records that you yourself love and you will be proud of in 100 years' time, you know, is an attitude that they're adopting.
I don't think music scenes now can ever be as pure as Northern Soul because there is too much media around nowadays, especially in the UK, means that no scene gets the chance to develop in the way that Northern Soul did.
Northern Soul never got commercialised because I think just because of the era it was in, I think that the era we live in now is everything. You know, everyone's business-minded, so everything gets commercialised. And I think 20 years ago, there wasn't as many businessmen around. And I think that's why Northern Soul stayed where it did.
There's no artists, and that's no good for record companies. Record companies want an act, they want an album, they want a video. It just doesn't lend itself to that. It doesn't lend itself. It only works when you're surrounded by a load of friends, you're on the dance floor, and you're in that moment.
Was the forerunner of the dance scene. It was the rave culture of the 70s, and it built and built.
I mean, the real reason is just because the music's so bloody good. It's going to be hard to beat. I can't see in the next 1,000 years anyone beating the musical output of the 40s to the 70s. And Northern Soul is a big part of that. And when folk get into Northern, it's hard to get out.
It's responsible for loads of things, and for a lot of people. That's why it's filtering into the media now. You know, those people have developed their lives and their jobs, and now they're in positions, you know, involved with media and whatever, and you can see all that music sneaking through.
People like me, who were attracted to Northern Soul, you know, we've taken it into our area, be it house, be it deep disco, be it even some mad rocky records that no one knows about.
It has definitely influenced me as a DJ because I like songs. I like songs that move you. I like songs that have something to say emotionally, spiritually, songs that elevate your spirit.
Well, the most expensive one in my collection is The Sought After, Don Garner, Cheating Kind. First heard Richard Sterling play it at the Wigan Casino. Blew my head away. Absolutely fell in love with it. Dreamed like one day I'd love to own a copy of that. And unfortunately, that dream came true about 18 months ago.
Last year was the first time I heard Cheating Kind. Oh, We're Gonna Make It. I hadn't never heard them. I recorded them and forgot about it. And then all of a sudden, they sent me a tape, and I said, well, I'll be darned. I had to learn them.
I got a friend of mine in Wales, a collector, Paul Robinson, decided he was selling it, so I had to have it. And the tidy little sum of £8,000.
So far as I'm concerned, it was just something we did, and I'm glad that it made some noise. But it's a shock to know people pay the kind of money they pay for records of mine.
There's only 4 known copies of Don Garner's Cheating Kind in the 30-year history. It's the most sought after 45 probably on the Northern Soul scene. And you can see it's such a lovely condition, takes pride and joy. And people ask me £8,000 for 45. Well, you know, I'm happy paying that. Bonkers, you may say so, but you know, I've got the record now, I'm so happy chap.
It's ridiculous, but it's good. Only drag is I don't get none of that money, you know, but otherwise than that, it's all right. You know, I don't worry about it. You know, what's meant for you, you'll get it. If it ain't meant for you, you won't get it. That's simple as that.
In a way, it's something that we need more today, really, because we're all so locked into, like, our career paths and what we should think we should be doing and what he's got and what she's got. And it was good to see such a light-hearted approach to it, I think.
The Northern Soul scene and the people connected to it, be them collecting records, DJing, CDs or just dancing, the reason they're there is because the nature of these records make them feel a certain way.
And I think that's why it's lasted so long when all these other different crazies come in, that Northern Soul things, it stays steady, true to the roots. It's a form of music that you can grow old with. It don't become old-fashioned to you. It just sounds better and better because when you look back through those years, then all you have to do is put the record on and you see your old school friends. If you wanna be kissed, yeah, yeah, you've got to be with a man. If you wanna be
hugged in a way that's so thrilling, you gotta open up your heart and let love run it in. If you want satisfaction, mama, you gotta have an old mind. If you wanna be a mover and a mover.
a lovely memory.